If you've been on this channel long enough, you know two of my favorite passions are music and movies. When I'm speaking on behalf about movies and music, I'm not talking about musicals, even though there are some great musicals out there that I really enjoy. Nor am I here to talk about movie scores, because that is a whole different topic that I could definitely deep dive into, but we're not here to talk about that. I'm specifically talking about music in movies. What do you mean, music in movies? Songs that just set the vibe for the movie or the scene that it's incorporating in. There are so many examples that I could reference here all day, but instead, we'll be counting down my top 10 favorite music moments in movies from slowest to fastest. We'll begin with the slowest beats per minute, reaching all the way to the highest beats per minute. So if you have a metronome or just a music nerd like me, you'll might enjoy this top 10 list. And before I can start the video, make sure to hit the like and subscribe button. Give the channel a like and a subscribe. Follow me on TikTok and all social media platforms. And sometimes I go live on Twitch, so come and check me out on there as well. All right, we can begin the video now. Up first on the list, we have The Batman from 2002, directed by Matt Reeves. Nirvana, Something in the Way, off a 1991 album, Nevermind. Since day one, I've been saying that Robert Pattinson's Batman with Matt Reeves works on so many different levels, and the thing is, a lot of people disagreed when they first heard the news that Robert Pattinson was going to become the Batman for the 2002 movie. A lot of people were skeptical about it, and I understand because of Robert Pattinson's background with certain movies about sparkling vampires and spider monkeys. I'm not sure what he's talking about. A lot of people were skeptical about him first for the role. And I like to revert back to The Dark Knight. Yes, Christopher Nolan. We're talking about that trilogy again. I know people are sick and tired of Christopher Nolan and The Dark Knight trilogy and how it's, you know, one of the best Batman adaptations. Okay, we get it. What I'm talking about is the casting for the Joker. Heath Ledger was cast as a Joker, and a lot of people were very opposed about it at the time, thinking this pretty British boy ain't gonna be looking so, you know, Joker-like. And boom, literally is one of the main influences for a lot of Joker cosplay, a bunch of everything like that. It's insane to see how much hate Heath Ledger got for accepting the role as Joker first, and then we saw the final product on the screen, we were just blown away. I've been a big Batman fan since I can remember, since the animated series, for God's sake. Minor spoiler alert for anybody watching the top 10 list for any of the movies, because you may or may have not seen the movies, and I don't want to spoil anything of this, so please be warned, there are spoilers ahead. Proceed with caution. One thing that kept me coming back to the Batman 2022 was the use of Nirvana's Something in the Way. Sure, there was a fluctuation of memes and a lot of people saying this is sad Batman, emo Batman, whatever they want to say.
Something's in my ass.
Overall, this was definitely a gritty, more grounded, mature Batman. It's so amazing to see this type of Batman on the screen. Having the song Something in the Way definitely adds the factor of this Batman is broken, this Batman not sure if the city can be saved. He pushes himself, though. He tries. He wants to save Gotham City, but at this point, he doesn't even know if he's saving himself or destroying himself in the process of trying to save the city. One of my favorite moments from the monologue in the beginning was, "Fear is a tool. They think I'm hiding in the shadows, but I am the shadows. I wish I could say I'm making a difference, but I don't know. Murder, robberies, assault 2 years later, they all add up. And now this, the city's eating itself. Maybe it can't be saved, but I have to try, push myself. These nights all roll together in a rush, behind the mask. Sometimes in the morning, I have to force myself to remember everything that happened." That just gave me the biggest chills in my life ever in theaters, and that's not the part that I want to talk about. The part that I want to talk about is immediately after following Riddler's first victim at the crime scene, Batman shows up and sees that another young boy is there as well, lost and confused, alone, scared. Batman just doesn't see a young boy. He sees himself. He sees what he was like when his parents were murdered all those years ago. Then just slowly we descend into Something in the Way by Nirvana, and we slowly hear the guitar pick up. We see and we follow Gotham City through the night. Batman is heading back to the Batcave. It's insane. It just, the song sets the whole vibe for the movie from there on out. If you go and listen to the lyrics for Something in the Way, it talks about a time when Kurt Cobain was homeless and was under the bridge eating fish, just feeling dreaded, just feeling defeated, almost as the same way as Batman is feeling. Immediately hearing the song in the background, you just start to sense the dread, the tiredness, the loneliness, the dark, nocturnal feeling that Robert Pattinson's Batman, Bruce Wayne, is feeling, struggling to keep the appearance of himself in both the public eye, yet trying to be the guardian of the night for Gotham. It's difficult for him. He has to adjust from daylight to night in an instant, prefers the night. He's becoming more of Batman than he is Bruce Wayne, and it's just taking a toll on him. Kind of gives the same sense of hopelessness and sense of dread and tiredness. This is barely year two Batman, and he's just not sure even if the city is worth saving for. Matt Reeves definitely put in such a good choice of song in that for the particular scene in the beginning and towards the end of the movie as well. Next up on the list, we got Baby Driver from 2017, directed by Edgar Wright. The Damned, Neat Neat Neat, from the album Damn Damn, 1977. If you know anything about Edgar Wright and his style of directing, you know that this man definitely takes it to a different level. You may have seen one of his movies or heard of, such as Shaun of the Dead, Hot Fuzz, The World's End, and the most famous of all, Scott Pilgrim vs. the World. The first time I got to see Baby Driver was at a free screening, which was about 2 weeks before it was supposed to come out, and you goddamn right know that I went back 2 weeks later to go watch it again. Within the first 10 seconds of the movie, you know that you're in for something different. You know that you're in for something that only someone as crazy and as amazing of a director Edgar Wright is. You know that this is going to be something special to watch and to listen to think about even after the movie is over. I've always been a huge sucker for behind the scenes footage and DVD commentary, for those that even know what DVD commentary is, or still even watch movies on a DVD player, not stream, because that's one thing that I honestly miss about DVDs is the DVD commentary and the bonus features. The one specific scene that I want to talk about from Baby Driver is the bank heist scene. Besides the fact that Edgar Wright picked one of my favorite English punk rock bands, The Damned, for this scene, it has to be one of my favorite memorable scenes in the whole entire movie, and the one that a lot of people seem to have remembered watching in the theater or remember watching the trailer from this specific part. Once the music starts cranking up, you know shit's gonna get real with the movie, and the fact that we as an audience get to listen to whatever Baby Driver is listening to within the movie, we also get to listen. We just kind of get placed into the scene of, man, the tension is high. This is really happening and I'm terrified. My heart is pumping. The music is just getting faster and faster. It's insane. I could have easily picked the beginning song or another song off the Baby Driver soundtrack and movie, but honestly, this song specifically stuck with me, and this is one of the most memorable scenes from the movie that I personally remember. If you don't want to watch the movie, or if you just kind of want to spoil that scene specifically for you, it's on YouTube. Feel free to watch it. But overall, I recommend watching the full movie as a soundtrack, and the acting, Edgar Wright is just pure genius for this movie. From what I've been hearing all around is that there is a Baby Driver 2 sequel in production or pre-production. It's been quite quiet for a while, but I would love to see where they would take Baby Driver 2, and hopefully Edgar Wright comes up with the script, because if he's not included in it, then I don't want it, but it'd be very interesting to see what they could do with the sequel. Overall, this scene is full of action, full of laughs, and full of nonstop, just heart-pounding what-the-fuck moments, and damn, you really do feel as if you're the one in the seat with Baby Driver listening to this song. Up next on the list, Fight Club, directed by David Fincher, 1999. The Pixies, Where Is My Mind, from the album Surfer Rosa, 1988. So to begin with, this is basically gonna spoil the ending of the movie for those that don't know. So spoilers for 1999's Fight Club, in case you don't wanna know. here is the timestamp. If you just want to proceed to the next one, you could just come back to this, or if you don't care, stick around. Before I could get to that, let's go back and talk about David Fincher, who has basically gave us some of the best psychological thrillers out there and has basically almost gotten a lot of praise from the Academy nominees, three of them being Best Director. Some of his best work besides Fight Club is also Seven with Brad Pitt and Morgan Freeman, Gone Girl, Zodiac, The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, The Social Network, The Curious Case of Benjamin Button, and my personal favorite, Alien 3. In almost every David Fincher movie, he really dives into the psychological thriller across the main character or the characters that are around them. A lot of people would like to compare David Fincher to David Lynch, since having almost a similar vibes, and I could definitely see the George Lucas, Steven Spielberg dynamic going on, but from my knowledge, I don't think they've ever worked on a film, or they might have been friends. There's some history between both of them, in good terms. The first time that I watched Fight Club, I had no idea what the hell the whole movie was going on. But to be honest, in my defense, I was just about 14, bro, and I just thought it was cool. With understanding now the ending and seeing all these YouTubers explain to me about what the real meaning of the movie, what the real meaning of the ending is, it just sort of makes sense. And I could sit here and try to explain it to you, but honestly, it'll just add another 5 to 10 minutes on the video, and I don't want to do that. After what seemed like 2 hours of just mind-boggling just what moments throughout the movie, we finally reach to the ending and we start piecing the pictures together, and we finally see what the main character of the narrator of Edward Norton was trying to do all along. And we see him and his girlfriend hold hands together as they watch the buildings around them collapse slowly from explosions, with the Pixies' Where Is My Mind slowly playing in the background, almost like it's a soundtrack to the apocalypse or the end of the world, as most would say. But it is such a good scene, such a memorable scene that a lot of people definitely would reference as one of their favorite scenes and one of the most important pieces of dialogue in movie of all time. You met me at a really strange time in my life. Man, that first time seeing it, I'm just like, what the hell had I just watched? I enjoyed every second of the score in the background. Just how the first note started playing as soon as the first explosion hit on the building was nuts. It just gives one of those dark, eerie endings where you're just like, is this even a happy ending? It's just an ending, but you're just so astounded by like the explosions, the quote, and just to this day, I could still watch that movie and that ending would still give me shivers down my spine, just like the first time that I watched it. Up next, we have a newer movie, which is the reason why I have this video made, because I definitely wanted to talk about specifically this scene in this movie. I'm talking about Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, 2023, from director James Gunn, Beastie Boys' No Sleep Till Brooklyn, from their License to Ill album, 1986. Out of all the directors on this list, I would personally say that James Gunn is hands down one of my most favorite inspirational directors of all time. Most people may or may not know that James Gunn actually wrote the 2002 script for Scooby-Doo and Scooby-Doo 2 Monsters Unleashed as well. Or you are probably a newer fan that is only familiar with his works on Avengers Endgame, Avengers Infinity War, Guardians of the Galaxy, the Iron Groot Disney Plus TV show. But for me, I know James Gunn from the 2004 movie Dawn of the Dead, 1996 Romeo and Juliet, and one of my most favorite movies of all time, 2006's Slither. Spoiler territory ahead, so if you haven't seen Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, please proceed ahead and come back later to the video. But if you have, you know what scene I'm talking about specifically. James Gunn really incorporates the songs into the script as he's writing the film and as he's storyboarding, from what I believe. And Guardians 3 did not disappoint at all with that hallway fight scene, that still one-shot tracking movement of the camera. Everything is so slick. Everything is almost in slow motion. The song is pumping. Everybody's cheering. The Guardians are whooping everybody's ass in that hallway scene. And just everywhere you look, something amazing or something awe is just happening. And just to have it in all in one continuous take with the tracking and just so much comedic timing going on from everybody. A little bit of all the Guardians get to shine at their time as well. Everybody's doing something. Everybody's hurling. Everybody's freaking just throwing knives or just cracking backs, putting things up people's butts, blowing stuff up. It's just all amazing. One of my favorite scenes, without a doubt. I definitely was just at the edge of my seat during that scene. Soon as I heard the tone of No Sleep Till Brooklyn, I knew we were in for something insane. And as soon as I got home, I wanted to go back to the theater and immediately rewatch that scene specifically. That just drove me and my adrenaline rush so much higher than it was by just seeing the scene and just feeling as if you were part of the Guardians of the Galaxy team in that moment, in that hallway, fighting for your life, just tired of running from what Raccoon said and just ready to annihilate everything and everybody in that room. The whole soundtrack to Guardians of the Galaxy 3 has to be one of the best soundtracks for a Marvel movie in a very long time. But without a doubt, the No Sleep from Brooklyn scene with the Guardians fighting in the hallway one last time just definitely is a bittersweet moment as well, knowing this is one of their final fights and this is one of the last moments that we'll see this interpretation of this specific team of Guardians of the Galaxy. It's just so bitter yet so satisfying to see that everybody's working so together, everybody has the same goal, and just to see everybody work as a team makes it even better. It's so badass. Everybody has their time to shine. Everybody works so well together. There's just those moments where you're like, oh my God, that's just happened. Or, oh man, you know, the tracking of the camera when we're going through inside one of the high evolutionaries creatures. It's just insane just to see all that. Definitely one of my favorite moments and definitely one of my favorite movies of the year so far. As of June, I am still bumping the soundtrack because it is so badass and there's just so many memorable moments. I definitely can't wait to watch this again on Disney Plus or get it on Blu-ray, whichever one comes first. Coming up next, we have 2009's Zombieland, directed by Ruben Fleischer, Metallica, For Whom the Bells Toll, from the 1984 album Ride the Lightning. I specifically remember watching Zombieland in a theater with a friend of mine because his mom had just bought us tickets for the movie and they allowed us to go see the movie even though it was rated R and I was at a certain age where I wasn't even close to being 17 yet. So it was pretty cool to see it in a theater. In the beginning of Zombieland, we have Jesse Eisenberg explaining how the world has just become the United States of Zombieland. There are a certain set of rules and just establishing the universe. After setting up the tone and going over some of the few rules that we're gonna learn along the way in order to survive Zombieland, we're hit with Metallica's For Whom the Bells Toll, the intro to Zombieland, which I have to say, this is one of the best intros to a movie in general. This has something up there. It's up there. The way just the music pumps up, the montage, the special effects on all the zombies, the chaos, everything just fits so well. It's just you're thinking, my freaking God, this movie is gonna be downright bloody, funny, and awesome as hell. Just alone will give you the chills of the introduction. You know you're in a good for time for it. Every bit of the montage during this song is hilarious. I can't show specific parts of it, but you can watch it on YouTube. Hands down, without a doubt, one of the best horror comedy introductions of a movie ever, freaking period. Just go watch it on YouTube. Go watch the whole movie, actually. It's one of my favorites. Freaking bonus points for just having Metallica blasted in a movie theater. Like, come on, that movie theater bass just hits different. That whole beginning, the glass shattering when the title card for Zombieland came out. Fucking amazing. Without a doubt, this is gotta be one of the best uses of songs for a movie in general. the editing team definitely knew what they were doing and what they had their hands on. Just the last couple seconds too, when the directed by comes up and the zombie just shatters the glass and you just hear it and the song just faints out. Fucking perfection, man. 10 out of fucking 10. I love this movie. Also, yes, I am aware of the second movie. I have watched it. I went opening weekend to watch it. We'll get to that in a little bit. We're just talking about the first Zombieland right now. Coming up next on the list, we have 2018's Deadpool 2, directed by David Leitch, Dolly Parton, 9 to 5, from her 1980 album 9 to 5, and Odd Jobs. One of my favorite moments from the first Deadpool movie was his introduction when he was on top of the bridge waiting for the cars to come and fighting everybody on the highway. That was probably one of the most memorable scenes from the trailer and from the movie in general that a lot of people will remember. But I'm going to step it up a bit. I'm going to talk about the second movie that came out, and we're going to talk about the assassin scene in the beginning of the movie. That whole montage of him becoming a known mercenary, just being able to go around in his red spandex suit and just start murdering everybody for his job and just bringing home the dough. Just the whole moment between having Dolly Parton's 9 to 5 and just so much insanity going on, him traveling around the world killing people to this song, and just the one-liners. It's amazing just to see that they were able to use 9 to 5 in that montage, because without a doubt it definitely sets up the tone and the theme of Deadpool 2 as just someone that is working their 9 to 5 job, assassinating people, mobsters, etc. Just knowing the comedies of Deadpool and his one-liners, it definitely is fitting for him to listen to Dolly Parton. Even right before the montage started, he even said, "Hit it, Dolly," and the song just started playing immediately. Just shows how much funny and the fourth wall breaks. It definitely sets the mood for it. I was just laughing my ass off in theaters watching that for the first time, and I still laugh my ass off because it's so good. It's definitely an upgrade from DMX's X Gon' Give It To Ya and Salt-N-Pepa's Shoop. It's definitely up there with one of the best songs and one best introductions for a character. But I personally feel that Deadpool 2 and the use of Dolly Parton in that scene steals all those songs out of the way. It just definitely shows the humor of Deadpool, yet the seriousness of him trying to assassinate as many people as he can, since he's just earning a living. He's just working his 9 to 5. It's definitely fitting for the character to have a love for Dolly Parton and all kinds of music, so this is definitely fitting, and how they were able to get the song, I will never know, but I hope one day Dolly Parton watches this, or if we could get a reaction of her watching this, I would love her. She is so awesome. Next up, we have Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse from 2018, directed by Peter Ramsey. Black Way, What's Up Danger, from the 2018 Spider-Verse soundtrack. Once again, spoiler warning for those that have not seen this movie or the sequel, but we're just going to be talking about the first movie here from 2018, so spoiler warning ahead. I could have easily picked the song Sunflower with Post Malone and Swally, but honestly, I wanted to pick this song just because of how much this means to the character, how much of a big portion this song takes place, and just the most important scene of the movie of all is when this song is played in the background and just shows how Miles is ready to take that leap of faith, be able to become Spider-Man, how anybody could be behind that mask, how anybody could be Spider-Man. It just takes a leap of faith to do it. Just how the lyrics and how Miles is just anticipated, been waiting to jump off a building. This is probably his third attempt at trying to jump the building, but he finally manages to take that leap of faith, finally manages to become the Spider-Man he sought out to be, and finally go kick some fucking ass. That leap of faith scene definitely is up there with one of those moments where Spider-Man finally becomes Spider-Man. Those moments of just knowing we're getting into just more serious territory. We're just getting into right where we need to be. The most climax moment at the time is during that song. I loved every second of it, and even just then, you feel yourself be Miles. You feel like you're taking that leap of faith with him as well. Just the use of the song of Can't Catch Me Now, What's Up Danger, being able to confront the fear head on and just say, what's up, danger? Like, you know, like, oh, what's up? You know, what's up? What are you going to do now, bro? What are you going to do now? You know, type of vibe. But it goes well with the transition scene of just jumping off the building and the slow-mo for a few seconds. It definitely captures all that. The soundtrack for Spider-Verse is a really good soundtrack. There's other songs that I have chosen from the soundtrack and scenes that have used it within the movie as well. But honestly, the Leap of Faith scene has got to be the most important one and my personal favorite one. Oh look, another comic book movie that a lot of people didn't know that was based off a comic. We're talking about 2014's The Kingsman: The Secret Service, directed by Matthew Vaughn. Leonard Skinner, Freebird, from their self-titled album Leonard Skinner 1973. Yes, we are talking about the Matthew Vaughn that directed the first Kick-Ass movie. You definitely know we're gonna get a lot of action, a lot of blood, and a lot of like holy fuck moments during a Matthew Vaughn movie that he's based off of a comic book, because that man definitely knows how to write in the action. The scene that I want to particularly talk about is the church scene. So from what you need to know, Samuel L. Jackson is a rich billionaire bad guy who's trying to control everybody with the power of the SIM card by using, I believe, a certain amount of frequency of music or just some form of frequency to make everybody haywire that may or may not have a SIM card. And that's when the badass moment of everybody just starts beating the hell out of each other in that church. The movement of everybody in the church getting killed, getting destroyed, getting punched in the face, getting shot in the mouth, a bunch of different scenes, all just captured so closely, so tight, so good editing. You could definitely make out when there was cuts, when it was just done to make it seem as if it was one continuous take, but it doesn't take away from the fact that the action is nonstop. The action is just so bloody, violent, it's amazing. It's just like watching an orchestra. Having Freebird in the background just makes it 10 times more intense. As the song just gets faster and faster, everything around you and the movie just feels like it's gotten faster than it should. Everybody's getting shot up, everybody's getting hurt, and it just continues. You're just thinking, how is there this many amount of people in a church like that? And it just keeps going and going. You probably saw this scene from Family Guy as well. There was an almost somewhat nod to it in the lunch hall scene in Family Guy. I'm not sure what episode or what season, but if I do find it, I'll post it up here. That scene is almost a direct reference to this movie as well. So it just definitely shows that that movie has definitely had a cultural impact on people that love really intense action movies like that. And Matthew Vaughn definitely knows how to direct that steady cam, the panning of the camera and the cuts, just adding into it and the little editing marks. All of it is just amazing. The Kingsman, The Secret Service has to be one of my favorite movies of all time. I believe that Netflix picked up Matthew Vaughn's company and they're working on making a TV show for Netflix within the Vaughn universe of The Secret Service, Kick-Ass, anything that he has his hands worked on is what they might be doing, a reboot for a TV show or a movie or whatever they're doing at Netflix. But I know that they have a contract now, so we'll just wait and see to what goes on with The Secret Service universe with that, because I want more scenes like that from The Kingsman. That scene with Freebird has just felt so in place with how the action is, how steady everything was. You cannot look away and you could see all the framing of the action within the sight of line. You literally could just focus on one spot in the movie and you could see all the action, you could see so much. And I am blown away about how much this scene really made an impact on me the first time I watched it. We have the final two songs that I want to talk about. 1999's Office Space, directed by Mike Judge. The Ghetto Boys, Still, from their album The Resurrection, 1996. I previously talked about Mike Judge and his creations, Beavis and Butthead, on my Childhood Fears video. And I'm not here to talk about King of the Hill since I briefly mentioned it in that video as well, but if you want to know what I have to say about that, here's a video to go watch. Yes, there is another Family Guy parody that you might have saw, because I know when I first watched the movie, I understood the parody that they were doing and I just loved it so much. I'm talking about the moment in Office Space when everybody gets together and just starts smashing up the crap out of the printer. It's out of magenta, it's not working, it's a universal issue that we still have today. But imagine back in 1999 when all this was still working, when we still had dial-up, when we still had those little floppy disks, or as some people of this generation may call it, the little save icon. It was a difficulty to work with technology back then, as it is almost now. The choice of song just definitely adds to the factor, and during the time capsule of that, it really catches it, and it is just so funny as hell to just see three dudes beating the crap out of a printer, because we've all felt that way about technology of some sort. And the fact that it's 2023 and that we still have issues with printers like that, it blows my mind. It's just a universal thing that always has happened with everybody. The printers, the technology, you know? Sometimes you just want to beat the crap out of it and you're just like, work, 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 damn it. So just seeing three dudes literally beat the crap out of a printer machine to this song really just makes it so much funnier than it already is. And just seeing everybody's reaction of like busting down the printer and knowing that it's had enough beating really just makes it funny. I love this scene and I love this movie. I think everybody should definitely go watch Office Space. If you're a King of the Hill fan, if you're a Beavis and Butthead fan, please go watch Office Space. It's one of the best comedy movies ever written of this generation. And rounding out the list of the top 10 songs in movies that I personally enjoy, we have 2017's Thor Ragnarok, directed by Taika Waititi, Led Zeppelin, Immigrant Song, from Led Zeppelin 3, 1970. When this song wasn't used to promote cars or commercials, it was used in movies, and almost a lot of movies definitely use this song. One of those being School of Rock, one of my favorite movies of all time. I'm gonna have to give the spot to Thor Ragnarok because it is definitely more kick-ass scene that has happened on that, and it definitely just sets up the whole climax of the movie at that point where we see Thor has become the god of thunder. He has got his powers back. He's saving everybody from Asgard. Everything about it is amazing. The lead up to it, the catchphrase of "I'm the god of thunder," and then the doon 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 doon, just the whole scene in general, everything about that moment in Thor Ragnarok up to that moment has led up to the case. I was just bawling my eyes out when we were there with Odin and Thor, and he was just talking to Loki and just told him to look over there. That scene impacted me and it just hurt me so much. But being able to see Thor is able to carry on, Thor is able to get himself together and just push forward into the final battle, just knowing he has that charged soundtrack going on in the background. It's definitely one of the best uses of a Led Zeppelin song. It definitely captures exactly what Taika Waititi was looking for in Thor, and it definitely shows the strength and just how powerful the god is of thunder. Damn, I was not expecting for this video to go longer than 10 minutes, but I guess here we are. So if you guys made it through the whole video, thank you so fucking much, because I appreciate you. I just wanted to make this list up because I have a true passion for music and movies as well. So just being able to combine both into one video, come up with a top 10 list, just made me very happy. I love talking about this stuff with you guys. Comment down below, which song from the top 10 list did you like personally? Or choose a personal song that you like from a movie. Just please keep the spoilers out of the comments. Till next time, this is your boy Griv signing off, reminding you, join the Discord, follow me on Twitter, follow my Insta, sometimes I'm live on Twitch, and don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and hey, share the video around if you think somebody else would dig it. Alrighty, that's it for me. I'll see y'all until the next one. Click on another video or stick around and enjoy the music. Bye-bye.